It says in Jeremiah 15, 20, it says, I am with you to save you, says the Lord. I am with you to save you. Thank you so much. So we're walking along and I'm showing your love and I'm trying to have self-control and I'm trying to be gentle and I keep thinking about this person that hurt me and I stumble and fall because I can't get past my forgiveness. I just can't. I think of you hanging from the cross saying, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. What an example that is for me to have somebody turn on me and say some ornery things. I'm supposed to forgive them because they know not what they do. Excuse me. That's just downright rude. Doesn't everybody know what rude is? However, forgive them for that. But I can't. Not only am I having difficulty forgiving them, I can't even forget about it. I have a feeling you know exactly what I'm talking about. And there's two sides of this forgiveness. It's not just about forgiving the one that's done damage to us, but it's also those who's done the damage, who's wondering if they're good enough to be forgiven. Amen. So forgiveness is a big deal when it comes to wanting to really truly experience those nine fruits of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit doesn't hold grudges. He doesn't count, well, you hurt me 22,000 times, so I'm going to expect it at least another dozen. I mean, how many of us do that? Hello? I'm not going to send my kid to that teacher because the last time I did, I wanted to slap that teacher upside the head. And the teacher hasn't changed. And I haven't either. Thank you. However, if we're believers and followers, and our scars, however, are so deep and so profound, it's just almost we're unable to release the hate and the vile and the anger that we can feel towards our enemy. But the first thing that we have to remember comes from John 15:5. If you want to, write that down. Because it says, without me, Jesus says, you're not going to do nothing. You can go to counseling, you can read the book, you can go through analyzing, you can do the training, and you need to do all of that. Because I gave that to you. However, for that heart to stop being stony, it's only going to happen with me. End of story. You can try till the cows come home, but you're going to need me. You're going to need me and my Holy Spirit. I was thinking to myself of the example. You know, I love to use examples and illustrations for our sermons that we give, the lessons that we give. And I was thinking of a man that we all know. March 17th or 16th, isn't it? St. Patty's Day. Isn't that the day that we always think of him as the guy with the green hat and in the pubs or something like that? But I want to talk to you guys who, I mean, a lot of you might not know the real story of St. Patrick, because he was a profound man. He was about your age, my little darling, living in England when a marauding tribe of bad people kidnapped him and his schoolmates, a few of them, and took him to Ireland. Now, Ireland was a bad place. Ireland worshipped many different gods. They believed in slavery. Male dominance ruled the day. Brutality, human sacrifice, sexual perversion, all of this was the day. It was an absolute horrific place, if you think about it, to be kidnapped and taken to. And he was there for 6 years under a warlord. He was chosen by this high deity man, supposedly in Ireland, a warlord, chosen, that boy I want is mine. Can you even fathom how awful his life must have been and how it had to have been? But once he escaped, which he did 6 years later with the help of the Lord, Patrick had very, very difficult time once he returned home in fitting in. His wounds were prayed for over by the church, yet his memory still haunted him. the barbarism, the brutality, the evils that he saw and what was done to him, he could not forgive. He kept thinking about Jesus' example, forgive them for they know not what they do. But it was so hard, he couldn't even get past the forgetting. And it was while he was in captivity, he began praying day and night. And it says in his memoirs, if you read them, so beautiful, he didn't just pray day and night. He prayed, he woke up early and prayed like a dozen times. Then he would go to work and meet the warlord and go through whatever that went through. All through that, he's praying. Then he'd say he'd go to bed early and he'd pray and pray. He prayed all the time. He was constantly praying. But when he got home, he did exactly the same thing. Yet forgiveness was something that continuously escaped him. Then one day, this is so cool, then one day during his morning devotions, his Bible opened up to Romans 12:19, which is actually a repeat of Deuteronomy 32:35, and it simply says six words. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. Now, I'm sure that must have done something to him, stirred him up a little bit. Well, ooh, man, I mean, he had been thinking about these barbaric people and that warlord and all of those people and what they had done to him and yama, yama, yama. And now he's learning and he's reading this Bible that's telling him that vengeance is his. And I bet he's thinking, boy, you better hurry up because I want to go back there and slap somebody upside the head. You know what I mean? I don't know that he would have said it that way, however, but anyway, it's not in the Bible for sure. Anyway, that night, okay, his Bible opened, and it opened to Matthew 5:43, four verses that changed his life forever. And you're going to get to hear them again. It's not that you haven't heard them before. But let me read to you what it says. This is from the New King James. That says Matthew 5:43-47. Jesus said, you have heard that it was said by Moses that you shall love your neighbor and you should hate your enemy. But I say to you, you love your enemies and you bless those who curse you. You do good to those who hate you and you pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you so that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good alike, and he sends rain on the just and on the unjust. So, if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than them? Do you not even act like the tax collectors? Therefore, you shall strive to be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. End of story quote. Pretty cool, huh? Love your enemies. You've got to be kidding. When I went through classes years and years and years ago before I got my seminary degree, they had us do an assignment and they gave us a tablet, a big tablet. Wasn't a tiny tablet, a regular old three-ring spiral notebook. And they said, this is your homework for the week. And they gave us the whole brand new, we couldn't even use our old ones. You know what it was? It was a book of forgiveness. We were to write for 3 days the things that we forgave others of. That's all we were allowed to do, was just put down on paper. Nobody was ever to see it. But we were to write down all those people. He gave me a dirty look. He didn't choose me during the basketball pickup. You know what I'm saying here? Or he abused me brutally. My mother watched. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Whatever it was, you put those down. These are the people that have hurt you. You have hidden wounds inside of that heart. You keep writing, and don't you stop. That's your homework, Beverly Jean, and the rest of you who were, there was about 30 of us. Okay, so we did that. Then we got a call halfway through, and we were told to continue. But we thought we were finished. It was amazing how we continued, and we did fill up another many, 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 many more pages, perhaps by the same person doing the different thing, though. You see what I'm saying? A different memory, a different ouch, a different thing that will come up when somebody does something. It'll bring up that memory, that whole stack of ouches, okay? We went back the following week, Tuesday night, and we were told, okay, now, how much of the notebook do you have? It was about half full. Pretty much everybody in the class, it was about half full. They said, okay, now this is your homework for this week. We want you to go back and we want you to forgive yourself for everything you've ever done. We didn't have enough room for that. We had to start writing on the back of the pages, get another. I mean, there was so much. Then the following week, as we were to write to everybody that we had gratitude that we had arrived where we had arrived. And I remember I had 19 people. Some of my aunts were like, "What did you send me this letter for? I didn't do anything." Yes, they did. They were nice to me. They were kind to me. When my mother wanted to kick me out, they hugged me. When my father abused me, they loved me. Don't you say you didn't do anything. To my grandmother, "I didn't do nothing, honey." "Well, yeah, you introduced me to Jesus. Can't get better than that." Amen. Woo! So we ended up, we had to do that. "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." So during captivity, now this is very interesting, he prayed all the time. And so when he got home, he was doing the very same thing. So then he ended up praying about loving the enemy. He knew after those four verses that what he had to do, that he had to strive really, really, really hard for forgiveness. And that meant praying. So those two kind of went hand in hand. Then later, it got real clear that he was to return to Ireland to those very people that had kidnapped him. He saw, as a sidebar, this is very interesting, that his 6 years in captivity had really actually going to be, was going to be used and was used by the Lord to help the Lord's kingdom. While in Ireland, listen to this, he was able to acquire perfect language of the Celtic language. He was able to use that Celtic language to be able to then turn around and talk about the gospel to his enemies. Pretty cool, huh? That couldn't have happened had he not been kidnapped. I bet you 10 to 1 in the, over there in England, when they were teaching the Latin classes in church, Catholic church, they didn't teach Celtic. How much do you want to bet, right? So there was no way he was going to get over there and be a Savior's ambassador, so to speak, if he couldn't speak the language. The second thing that he did was the master that he worked for, the slave, he was a slave to, the warlord, he was also a very high druid. And Patrick became very, very familiar with all of the details of the Aborigines' Irish religions and all of the false gods that they had. Had he not been a slave, he wouldn't have known about that. He couldn't have spoke in their language and done an argument about from the King James and introduced them to his friend Jesus. Amen? Now, not only did he go back, can you imagine the trepidation he must have had? "I'm going to go to my enemies. They might make me serve another 12 years or something. They might really be mean to me." But he went with the Lord, and he went because the Lord told him to go. And he kept reading and reciting the entire time he was there from Psalms 23. And I wanted to read that to you because I think it's very, very important. In fact, that's what we're entitling this for the YouTube, if anybody is interested in seeing this. I don't know who would want to do that. But anyway, it's called Rev Bev Maui Sermons. Is that original or what? Oh, well. 23:4 Psalms. It says, listen to this, love. It says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." That death means in Aramaic separation. Separation from the Lord. So if I'm in trepidation, if I'm in fear about my health, my husband's health, my children's well-being, just go on and on and on and on. You see what I'm saying? That is a valley of the shadow of death, yeah? And he is saying, I don't care where you're at, don't you dare fear. Because I'm right here. I'm walking right beside you, darlings. And you won't probably even notice me because you're going to be so in your mire that you won't even know that I'm the one that's holding you up on your shoulders. So he kept reciting those and reciting those, and he knew that he had to voluntarily return to the nation that had held him captive to set them free from their own blindness, free from their own ignorance. So he returned and he spent the rest of his life devoted to saving Ireland from itself. He crusaded against and had victory, like our song spoke of, abolishing slavery. It was because of him. Abolishing human sacrifices. He was other than Jesus. He was the next great advocate for women's rights. Amen? He was the one that said there is going to be rules to war. The Prince of Peace has come. Yeah, but we got to fight for our rights. Well, then there's going to be rules. And the wartime rules began because of St. Patrick. His miracles in the name of Jesus became legend. He became known as the great saint of the downtrodden and the forgotten. By the time of his death, both Ireland and England were both referring to him as Saint Patrick. The thing that I wanted to close with today is for people, especially up there in the TV land or the computer land, the little ones to know is there's nothing that you have done that can't be forgiven. Those people in Ireland did some bad stuff back then, and they deserve to be forgiven. And it was Jesus who sent St. Patrick to do just that. So we are always being sent earth angels. We ourselves are earth angels to other people. If we think that we have been so hurt and scarred inside of our hearts, we must realize that it was Jesus that hung from the cross so that we could be healed, so that those scars could turn into stars. Robert Schuller used to always say that. I used to love that when he would say that. Anyway, so Patrick fought an evil that we still fight today. Did you notice that? Hello, think about Egypt. Think about all of those people that think that they can just abort anytime they want to. Hello, hello, hello. That they can go against the Bible. So we're still fighting it the same as he did in the fifth century. There's still barbarism today as back then. We still suffer from the wounds of torture, death, war, terrorism, divorce, sacrificial babies. We fight illness, disease, fear, false faiths. We all have wounded hearts, sadness and sorrows and regret and anger. And the answer is always the same. Go back to the Father and ask for forgiveness for yourself and for others. As we close, we must remember that we can't do anything without Him. If we can't forgive our enemy, guess who's won? You got it, the enemy. If the Lord wants to use us mightily, which He does, okay, Jeremiah 29:11, I have a plan for you and it's a plan of good. He has a plan, and if we're like getting so close to that plan, don't you think the enemy is going to come up and slap us up one? Make us remember about that time that we were slandered. Oh, that's right, I don't like those people. I'm not going to go over there. That's right. That's the family members that don't like me that always talk about me, so I'm not going to go over there either. Yeah, the devil says. Got her. He's not getting me if I have anything to do with it. And I surround myself with people that know me that says, oh no, Beverly Jean, you don't get to become Petty Patty. You don't get to play that little Petty Patty part. No, that was in the movies. You know what I mean? This is real life. This is eternity we're talking about. This is me being able to get rid of the darkness so that I can touch a child, so that that child might stand on a stadium someday and bring thousands of people to the Lord. We have no idea how He's going to use us if we can only get rid of, we take the fruit, we take the fruit, we're going to be gentle, we're going to be self-controlled, we're going to do all of that, but man, I'm not going to forget Him. Oh yeah? And then Jesus says, well then you're not going to get the blessings here on earth either. You'll get them to the degree that you can forgive and that you can live and that you can walk my way. But until you can forgive, my darling, you can't walk like me. Because I love them. I don't like what they did, but I love them. Words, looks, actions, these are the horrible weapons that inflict hidden wounds in our human heart. Now the question is, what do we do with these? How do we handle them? We drown them in prayer. We drown them by picking up the baton of light, covering ourselves with Jeremiah 30:17 that says, the Lord is going to heal me of my wounds. St. Patrick had been taken away as a captive, but through forgiveness and through immersing himself in God's arms, God was able to use him just as he is going to use us. Amen. He has not forgotten us. Though I walk through the shadow of the valley of death, I'm so frightened I could barely breathe. My breath is being sucked out of me. I cannot sleep at night, like David says. But then I am reminded of Psalms 23:4. Though I walk through the shadow of the valley of death, I'm not going to fear any evil anymore, because the Lord walks with me. And so it is. Let's pray. Sweet Jesus, we want to say thank you for saving and preserving these words that we have recited and listened and studied once again today. I don't believe that there's a person here or anyone even listening that hasn't heard these words recited to them before. But I pray, Lord Jesus, that these words will somehow prick their heart, their consciousness, that somehow there will be a healing for themselves and for those that have hurt them. Please, Heavenly Father, there are so many in this congregation today that have been so abused. They've been abused because of their friendship for you, with you. I know that. I know what that feels like to be bullied because I love Jesus. Oh, sweet Jesus, human race can be really ornery and mean. You were the perfect example of taking the wounds of mankind, but you gave us also the example of what we are to do. We are to love them. Forgive them, sweet Jesus. Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Forgive me, for I do also not know what I'm doing without you. So we bow before you, Heavenly Father, collectively this day. And we lift up ourselves and our enemies also. And we bow before you and collectively say, Our Father, whom art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And all of God's children in agreement said, Amen. All right.